Not much to add to what Andy just said here, but I want to try to just add a few anecdotes from my experience. I came here in 2008 from Minnesota as an activated Army Reservist JAG officer, having volunteered to come and represent Guantanamo detainees in the military commissions. So I was here from late 2008 until the end of 2012 on active duty, and I then retired. I watched the movie last night, and I've seen it before, and it's an excellent movie. I want to make a couple of points about it that I think are necessary to add. First of all, there's no exaggerations in there. When I first arrived in 2008, to fill my time until I got assigned to a case, a team of my own to work with, I helped a little bit on the JAWAD team. And everything that movie shows was exactly on point. There's no exaggeration there. JAWAD was a kid that they captured, accused of an offense that would not have been a law of war violation. Was not burdened violation of law of war. I won't go into that here on the detail of why that would not be the case. But they got that confession, it turned out later, from the Afghan police officers torturing the kid and threatening the family and whatnot until he confessed, is my recollection of the facts of that case. The attorney, Eric Montalvo, in there, and another attorney, Chris Kennedy, did an outstanding job and really vigorously worked on that and got him released. But incredibly, all along the way, in spite of the testimony by Ms. Porterfield, the Dr. Porterfield and whatnot, the U.S. government resisted every step of the way. And in looking at that case objectively and treating this kid, with any humanitarianism, preferring to stand on their initial claims that were obtained only by way of torture of the Afghani police. So that's how insistent they are upon the facts, even though they're repeatedly shown to be false. On the case, one of the cases I was on too, the person was now back in Sudan. Prosecution assured us how dangerous he was as a terrorist, etc. And it was only when we got a motion approved where there was going to be an Article 5 hearing finally, as required in the Geneva Convention, having overcome all the resistance by the prosecution, where the judge granted that motion, and all of a sudden, when there's going to be some scrutiny of the case by the court, then the prosecution is willing to begin talking about things, and it turned out the guy really wasn't too bad. Largely his crime had been doing some cooking in Afghanistan. So there's been all sorts of claims. The claims are always made in the most insistent manner of how dangerous these people are. But in every case where there's been harm done or somebody else, when there's actually been some scrutiny, those claims have evaporated. And it turns out, that there's a whole lot of reasons why they may have been captured, but being the most dangerous terrorist in the world is not one of them, factually. One example is Ali Soufan, the FBI agent who probably was the most conversant with people in the Mideast. And in his book, was Black Banners, he talks about how when we first got there, we went out and hooked up the Northern Alliance with the CIA and gave them vehicles. And one of the tactics they used to get bounties was taking their new vehicle into some village that had never seen a motorized vehicle, offering to give somebody a ride, and then when the person got on the vehicle, they drove them over to the nearest, U.S. military base that had been set up, U.S. military forces, and sold them as a bounty. That's from Ali Soufan. That's not me saying this. It's the guy who was directly involved in that whole process. So let me add a couple more things. One thing, going back to the movie I saw last night, I didn't watch again, but they mentioned sleep deprivation as being a form of psychological torture. And in fact, sleep deprivation is far more than psychological torture. That's not to criticize the movie in any way, but to supplement it. Menachem Begin and Alexander Solzhenitsyn both wrote about sleep deprivation was the absolute worst of the tortures inflicted upon them when they were by the Soviets. After a certain amount of time, the body just begins to deteriorate. Everything begins shutting down. And so it becomes a far worse torture than anything else, loud music, anything like that. Sleep deprivation was the absolute worst. The term that they used, and I looked into this on the Jawad case, and he'd been subjected to it, was euphemistically called the frequent fire program. And it just really shows a callous humor that can take over people when they resort to such forms of depravity, where we make a joke of this absolute horrible form of torture and call it something like the frequent flyer program. Guards who were down there, a few of them who come out and objected to this and later wrote about it and spoke out against it, you know, talk about how the whole system just sort of, made the people involved just sort of degrade themselves, where they came to accept more and more of this form of torture being inflicted upon the detainees. And I think the frequent flyer program term itself is an example of that. But the other thing, the movie shows, the role of the doctors involved in the torture and whatnot, is the other profession that was involved and remains involved in this whole torture program, and taking away whatever, is now being done or not being done as far as particular forms of torture, there's one gigantic form of torture remaining, and that is Guantanamo itself. Positions for Human Rights came out with a report shortly after, I think, this movie was done, where the study was on the effect of indefinite detention itself as a form of detention, as a form of torture. And they conclude that, yes, under certain circumstances, indefinite detention can be a form of torture itself. And we are seeing that more and more every day. We saw it most recently with the hunger strikers. And I think that began, obviously for a number of reasons, but not least of them was when, I think his first name was Adnan Lateef, his case got to the D.C. Appellate Court, his habeas case, and by 2-1, the judges denied his habeas petition. And it wasn't too long after that that he committed suicide, and somewhere along the same period of time, the hunger striking began. And if they talked about it there, I think they might have mentioned one of the interrogation techniques, or a couple of interrogation techniques, is to induce helplessness and hopelessness. And you look at Guantanamo itself as a whole, and the whole process is about inducing helplessness and hopelessness on the part of the detainees. Again, the whole threat of indefinite detention is to induce hopelessness on the part of these detainees, and Lateef and a few others have committed suicide as a result of it. Others have finally resorted to hunger striking, trying to break the bonds of this this indefinite detention hopelessness, being willing to die through their hunger striking because they know there's no other hope. Finally, just recently now we are releasing a few people, but and hopefully in response to this, because or in response to whatever, but anyway, indefinite detention itself is a form of torture, and perhaps maybe the cruelest form of torture of all. And to get to that, there's another profession involved, and that is the legal profession, the attorneys. And that goes back to the very beginning, 2001, when John Yoo, Robert Delahunty, a number of other attorneys working in the Office of Legal Counsel began issuing legal opinions that the Geneva Conventions were quaint, they don't apply. Everybody picked up in Afghanistan, allegedly, everybody was presumed to be Taliban or Al Qaeda, so no matter whether they were or not, they were presumed to be, and so they got no rights under the Geneva Conventions. And as we moved along in an appellate case, it says the defense attorneys have argued that, these offenses that most people are being charged with, or have been charged, the few that have been actually charged, and the others who are being directly being charged with material support for terrorism or conspiracy. And defense attorneys have argued that those are not war crimes. Military commissions are there only to try war crimes, or martial law cases or military government cases. Only in one of those three that applies is war crimes. And if material support for terrorism and conspiracy are not war crimes, then there is no jurisdiction for military commissions. And they are illegitimate. And that argument has been carrying the day. Even the D.C. Circuit Court has now agreed in the Hamdan case, the second Hamdan case, that these are not war crimes. So in the course of that, the government has changed their argument to say, okay, yeah, we agree, they're not international war crimes, but they are war crimes under a U.S. domestic common law war. And that is the most insidious argument that can come up with in the 21st century. What we're saying is, and just as Germany during the 1940s, World War II, basically had their own domestic common law war, that they applied to the occupied territories of France and Czechoslovakia, and they had the Nightfall Decree, where any opposition, just verbal, could be construed as resistance, and so they were captured, you know, just dissidents to military government under the Germans, would be returned to Germany, put in the People's Court, which was a military tribunal, and tried under people like Judge Roland Kreiser, and the most, you know, psychopathic person you could have imagined, and were being sentenced to death or just long captivity or whatever, indefinite detention. And the fact is, in the precedent that the government's using for our domestic common law war are those martial law cases of the Civil War, which may or may not have been justified during that past Civil War, but have no place today in the 21st century when Weaver's Code of the Civil War period was superseded by now Geneva Conventions, and we have entirely different protections. I just read an article on the Weaver's Code and why we should not be going back 150 years and turning back to an earlier version of law of war that did not have the protections that we, you know, progressively adopted in the 20th century in response to the Germans and the big reticence that they did during World War II. But now our military commissions prosecutors are returning to what they see as a more glorious day of law of war, where we, under our martial law principles, again, don't apply overseas, only here in our own territory during the Civil War, arguing that we can hold somebody that we capture overseas under a martial law principle of the Civil War. And that should outrage, that should really be outrageous. We talk about detainees' rights, detainees being deprived of their rights, and that's absolutely something that we should be concerned with and whatnot. But here's the bigger issue, is we have really genuinely upset our constitutional system by accepting military commissions. Military commissions, no matter what Brigadier General Martins talks about, have no place under a constitutional system. They're a system of executive branch courts without the guarantees, due process guarantees provided in our Constitution. We have had a very limited cases where they have been justified, and as Mark Martins and other prosecutors will argue, but we'll go into details, legal details of why that was justified, but it all happened because we caught enemy soldiers within our territory out of their uniforms, which is a violation that, you know, it gives us the right to self-protection, such as against a spy. But it does not apply to people we capture overseas in their territory, not in ours. And to sit there and argue that it is, and now we have, under Section 1021 of the NDAA, we provide that the law of war may be applicable to U.S. citizens. And that opens the door wide open for executive branch courts, whatever you want to call them, kangaroo courts, extrajudicial courts, to try American citizens. And that is a basically upsetting overthrow, if you want, of the constitutional system to a degree. And that should be the thing that should be of equal concern to the rights, you know, that detainees being detained. So let's not forget that, as we think that, again, be concerned with the detainees, the torture they're being subjected to, but also the torture that our constitutional system has been subjected to and is continuing to be subjected to.